I'm happy to be here because I think it's kind of surprising. I've been in this field for 35 years, and it's amazing that with the backgrounds that nursing home administrators and hospital administrators have, and with much of what we do being very similar, there's not an awful lot of interaction I've found. It's almost like we live in two separate worlds, but we're sharing patients back and forth consistently, and I think that's going to happen an awful lot more. So I was happy for the opportunity, and what I would ask is, if somebody has a question during my speaking, feel free to raise your hand. Somebody can bring a microphone over and we can, rather than waiting till the end, we can try to address it then. Over the last couple of days, you've heard from an impressive array of speakers about different ways to improve the quality of the care that you provide to your patients. And I know there's probably not a patient, there's not a person in this room who doesn't want to provide the best care that they can to the people who they serve. On top of this basic human desire to do what's right for those who need our assistance, we all also know that a reputation for high quality care is the best advertisement our facilities can hope for, and the bad quality scores on the array of report cards available to the public can result in a decline in our census numbers, and if not addressed pretty quickly, a rapid need to brush up one's resume. At this point, however, after 2 days of listening to lectures, you're probably saying, all well and good, but quite frankly, what do I have to learn from a hospital administrator about quality in a nursing home? Which I think would be my response if the tables were turned. However, I believe now, with the recently passed national health legislation, the Patient Protection and Affordable Care Act, it will force hospital administrators and nursing home administrators to become much closer partners if either one of us is to succeed. To start with, the Affordable Care Act will decrease the number of uninsured we both care for. That's more of an issue for a hospital than a nursing home, but may have some positive impact for you. But it'll also cut the reimbursement we receive for that care. It is, however, in many of its other provisions that the need for us to work together on improving quality will become absolutely critical to both of us. Probably the clearest opportunity for such collaboration is a result of the Affordable Care Act's implementation of financial penalties for hospitals that have higher than expected 30-day readmission rates starting in 2013. It will start with a focus on acute myocardial infarctions, congestive heart failure, and pneumonia, and will be expanded in 2015 with the addition of several other diagnoses, including chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Since CHF and pneumonia are, in my experience, the top two diagnoses for patients coming to hospitals from nursing homes, your ability to prevent a readmission within 30 days will become one of the keys to my financial success. The nursing homes that do so will be the ones that I want to send my new admissions to, and thus your ability to reduce readmissions will make you a more attractive partner for hospitals, give you a higher census, and I would argue also improve the quality of life for residents. Moving a resident back and forth between a nursing home and a hospital isn't in anybody's best interest. A slightly more complicated set of opportunities will arise from the newly created Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation. You might have heard of this, you might not have paid much attention, but it will begin operation this coming January and has been funded already to a tune of $10 billion with a B dollars for the period of 2011 through 2019. With that kind of money, it clearly has the potential to generate real change, and that change will affect both of us, since the center will oversee pilots and demonstrations to test payment and delivery system models designed to reduce spending while maintaining or improving access and quality, including but not limited to medical homes, accountable care organizations, and bundled payments. Probably the area of bundled payments is the one of these that has attracted most attention in nursing home circles, since it clearly has the potential of putting another set of hands between you and your Medicare payment, and a set of hands that would much prefer to give you as little of these funds as possible. While if I was sitting in your seat, I surely wouldn't be very happy with such a development, I'd also want to be pretty careful that I wasn't completely frozen out of any significant source of admissions due to a competitor having locked them up through a contract with an organization that receives such bundled payments. That is not to say that I'd take any deal offered to me, but only that I'd sure want to be sitting at the table attempting to negotiate a favorable deal. And while a clear goal of the organization controlling the bundled payment is to reduce payments for nursing home care, that doesn't necessarily mean lower per diems. A nursing home that can demonstrate shorter stays with lower readmission rates will, in my opinion, be able to actually successfully demand higher per diem rates for such service, and may also be able to generate significantly more admissions for patients that are previously going to another place that hasn't focused on the shorter stay and the lower readmission rates. Perhaps an even greater opportunity exists for nursing homes in the area of accountable care organizations. This component of the Accountable Care Act has generated the most interest in hospitals and medical group practices, even while the details are pretty fuzzy, and much of what we do know causes one to hesitate about getting involved. Basically, accountable care organizations will receive a significant share of the savings that Medicare reaps from reduced average per capita Part A and Part B Medicare expenditures for patients who receive a significant majority of their care from these organizations. Since there's no penalty if the costs exceed the averages, there would seem to be little downside. But the cost involved in developing an organization that can fully care for and account for at least 5,000 Medicare recipients is significant. Furthermore, and when you think about this, it's crazy, but it's the facts. Membership in the organization would be blinded to the Medicare enrollees who would be free to access care outside the organization without penalty. In spite of these weaknesses, however, there's been great early interest in the development of these organizations by both hospitals, healthcare systems, and in medical practices. And a handful of large medical group practices have participated already in a three-year trial program with some pretty significant successes with seven-figure paybacks to these organizations as their piece of the savings. As a result, I think it's fair to say that quite a few accountable care organizations will be established over the next several years by medical groups and hospitals. And they will obviously be looking to minimize the amount of money they spend on outside services. However, the dynamics of this effort will be very different from those related to bundled payments, since an accountable care organization will have absolutely nothing to do with the payments made to outside organizations, which will continue to bill Medicare directly as they have in the past. They will also have no direct control on where referrals are made, but only the indirect control on where, which a physician currently asserts through his or her recommendations.